Joining us now is Mark Timbal, a spokesperson of the Philippines' main disaster agency, the NDRRMC. Hi, Mark.
Sir Ron, good afternoon, and to all our viewers and listeners, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Now, we have Ambo battering some areas. We talked about Eastern Samar, also Camarines Norte, and also Quezon. Any reports of casualties so far?
So far, we haven't received any official report coming from our regional counterparts that have jurisdiction over the Samar provinces as well as in Bicol region. What we have received so far are anecdotal information on the damages that have been that have been incurred by these areas from the typhoon. So far, what we're seeing are the typical damages, such as the roofs of the houses that have been damaged, damages to light structures, as well as to trees and electric posts. We're hoping that in the next few hours, while our regional counterparts are consolidating the report, we would be able to receive the complete figures, even if by way of preliminary.
Now, Ambo has weakened into a severe tropical storm, but before that, of course, it was a typhoon. With LGUs along its path, probably still focused on fighting the pandemic, were they properly informed and updated about the situation and the forecasts of the track and the strength of Ambo?
Yes, Sir Ron. Actually, our preparations for Typhoon Ambo started Monday, earlier this week. So we have been informed by PAGASA, and we received description of the possible effects of this storm. So this was relayed or cascaded to our local governments, and we have informed them to give particular attention to specific areas in their jurisdiction which are flood prone, landslide prone, as well as storm surge prone. Along with that reminder is for them to ensure that the infection prevention mechanisms that we have, the protocols to protect our population against COVID-19 are also implemented during any evacuation activity. So what we saw, our evacuees left their houses wearing their masks. Our personnel in charge of the evacuation are wearing their PPEs. There's social distancing in the vehicles that were used to transport the evacuees, and the evacuation centers are also observing social distancing measures.
Now, we do have that problem in evacuation centers that were earlier converted into COVID centers. We have in Eastern Samar, the local government is having that problem of where to place the evacuated residents in some of their areas as well. Is the NDRRMC involved in the planning and trying to resolve that matter? Mark?
Part of our system is that even before an emergency happens, the local government should have identified various facilities or locations in their locality that can be used as evacuation facilities. In this case, that some of because of the COVID-19 situation, a number of these evacuation facilities, supposed evacuation facilities, were used as isolation facilities. These facilities should not be used as evacuation centers, and our local governments have done that. They are using the alternative or the other locations in their list of evacuation centers. If they're having difficulties in terms of housing our evacuees, there is they can use alternative facilities, and they can also coordinate with their colleague LGUs, so that if there are any available areas in their location, this can be utilized by their evacuees. They can also coordinate with the regional disaster councils so that assistance can be provided in identifying these additional facilities that they can use.
Now, Mark, a couple of other concerns with the centers with health workers. The DOH and the DSWD are part of this council. With health workers currently focused on fighting the pandemic, are you not concerned of the possible limited health workers manning the evacuation centers because of the evacuated residents because of Ambo?
Our system for camp management involves health workers monitoring the local health situation inside the camps. It's a fact that the people working in the health services in the LGUs are the same people who are also attending to the COVID emergency. Mm-hmm. So this is an additional function, but we are making sure that these personnel have the PPEs so that they can be protected from the risk of infection. Part of our system as well is that there should be regular monitoring. There is regular monitoring of the health situations in the camps, the evacuation facilities. And even before our evacuees are housed in the evacuation centers, they should have undergone the usual examinations like the thermal scanning for temperature from the presence of fever, as well as a sort of interview by the health workers to check if they are suffering from symptoms of a particular disease. Because right now, it's a fact that the symptoms for COVID-19 is very similar to the symptoms of the seasonal flu that is, of course, also happening right now. So we want to make sure that anyone who is exhibiting these symptoms will not be included in those evacuations that will be in an isolated facility that they can be observed to check for the progress of any or if they can recover immediately.
Finally,
with health assistance, of course, from our health workers.
Okay, finally, Mark, how about the distribution of aid? The DSWD also part of the distribution of relief packs. And aid for those affected by the lockdown. Are there still enough relief packages for those in evacuation centers? And does the DSWD still have enough funds to help them out?
Yes. Yes, we have in the latest report that I was able to see in terms of the stockpiles, we still have a lot of food packs and standby funds that can be used here on the national level to provide support for our LGU counterparts. Last I checked, there's still 200 million pesos standby fund that can be accessed that can be provided to LGUs who will be requiring assistance. But this requires them coordinating with the regional disaster councils so that they can still access the stockpiles that are prepositioned in their regions.
Mark Timbal, spokesperson of the NDRRMC. Thanks, Mark.
Thank you, sir.